Good evening, everyone. So I'm Hari. I work in the Gluster project for Red Hat. And right now with this session, you'll be seeing how to set up a Gluster volume and have a geo-replicated copy over in another place. So these things will be explained along with where geo-replication is headed in this presentation. So to start with, let me explain about Gluster so that you get an understanding about how things are actually going to work. So Gluster is a distributed file system which provides easy scale out when necessary. You can add as much storage as you want on the go without taking the cluster down. And the other benefit that Gluster has is it doesn't have a metadata server. So there is no bottleneck and we don't have a single point of failure as well. And you can run it on pretty much any hardware. You don't have to buy a box to make use of Gluster. That's another benefit. And it does provide you the basic features, file system features like replication, erasure coding, bitrot, and a few more. So the terminologies that you should be aware of during this presentation are what is a brick, what is a server, and all those. I'll explain one by one. So brick is basically your hard disk being mounted on some place in a machine. So this mount directory is going to be called as a brick. It's going to run as a separate process on the particular node. And server is the node where your bricks are going to reside. A server can have a single brick or multiple number of bricks and so on. And a volume is a collection of these bricks across various nodes. And this is a logical entity that we are going to use to perform various operations on Gluster. And then comes the client. So you have a Gluster volume which is being created, and now you can mount this particular Gluster volume on a particular node, and that's going to be your client. So all your operations on this particular client is going to be transferred back to server, back and forth, and that's what Gluster takes care of. And then comes the trusted storage pool. It's going to be a collection of servers within which you can create a volume and so on. All the operations you perform are going to be within the trusted storage pool. So as I said, you can see this diagram will help you understand better. There can be a number of servers which form a trusted storage pool. And within the servers, you can have any number of bricks as per the server's capacity. And a volume is going to be a collection of bricks from various servers. It can be within a server, between servers. The number of bricks, everything can be configured when you create the volume. And once the volume is created, you'll be mounting it on a separate machine, which will be the client, where you're going to do the IOs and so on. And yeah, about geo-replication. So why did we come to geo-replication? Basically, it's for disaster recovery. With normal replication, you can have it at a different place, but the IOs are going to take a long time to be synced between various places. So we go for geo-replication. The requirements from the geo-replication are you have to copy the files from one cluster to another. And you want to know until what point the data is being copied. So this is achieved through checkpoints. So we make a checkpoint at every duration, at every certain duration. So you know that until this duration, whatever data was there will be available in the replicated one. And then comes making the copying process efficient, and I'll be going into how we are making it efficient in the later part of the slide. So yeah, how did we achieve geo-replication with Gluster? The first thing is basically you have a volume which is supposed to be copied from one data center to another data center. So the first main volume is called as the master volume, and this master volume is going to be copied to a different data center, which is going to be called as the slave volume. And on the master side, every file operation that goes to the master volume will be getting recorded on the master, and these changes are called as change logs. And the change log is on the brick side, which I'll explain with the other diagram, like if you see it on the brick. So everything you write on the mount goes to the to various bricks as per the volume configuration. So when the IO goes to the brick records the change logs, so it knows what are the operations that were done on that particular brick. And yeah, that's basically a change log. And based on the way how a change log is generated, there are going to be three ways that we will be replicating the volume from the slave master to the slave. And the benefits of change logs is if you are trying to copy a particular file operation from the master to the slave, and if it errors out for some reason, you can retry that particular change instead of changing the whole file. And yes, that's how we create checkpoints as well. So saying until the 10th change log, we have synced to the slave volume, and so you have a checkpoint right now. And basically, as I said, in the trusted storage pool, you will be having a number of servers which you have created your master volume, and that master volume is mounted somewhere. So this whole thing that's written on the master volume has to be copied to a slave volume. So in your different, this is going to be a different data center. Like let's assume that's in Bangalore and this is in US. So you create a different volume over here using Gluster in US and make it a slave volume. And to the slave volume, you establish a Georep session which is going to copy your data to the slave volume. So how we copy the data is done in basically three ways. Let's assume that you have a volume which is already created, and before you create a session for geo-replication to copy, you would have a number of data which is already stored in your bricks. And as you haven't enabled the geo-replication already, you won't have this particular change log I was talking about on the brick side to know what are the changes that have been created. So at this point, you don't have change logs to sync. So what we do is we have something called a hybrid crawl, where you will be crawling the brick, and this will create pseudo change logs. And these change logs can later be consumed by the georep to sync from the master to the slave. So this is going to be the initial part where the sync is happening. And from here, you'll be going to the change log crawl. So once you have all the data up to the point copied, now whatever you write will be getting registered in the change log, and those changes are going to be synced from the master to the slave using the change log crawl. And the third unique scenario is you have a number of change logs which are already made available, but you have stopped your replication for certain reason. In this case, you wouldn't have synced the change logs. So there is a huge number of change logs which are present on the master that are yet to be synced. So here you use history crawl, which is going to consume all the change logs that have been produced so far from the master to sync it to the slave. So these are the three different ways we are syncing the data from the master to the slave. And then comes the various components that are involved in geo-replication. So as I said, your brick side will have a translator called, a translator is going to be a basic unit in Gluster which performs a certain operation. So this changelog translator receives every operation that is performed on that volume, and it starts recording it into a flat file. And whatever the changelog has recorded in the flat file will be later used by the process called agent. This reads the flat file and understands what is written in the flat file, like this particular file has been changed or created, and all those things will be in the flat file. And the agent is the one which is going to use this libgf API to understand what actually the flat file says, because those are binary files. From that, the agent gives the output to the worker, and worker is the one which is actually going to copy your data from the master to the slave. And this worker and the agent process are monitored by the monitor. So if one goes down, the monitor is aware that it has to start it back up, and so on. And these are the basic components in geo-replication, the internals. So as I said, let's assume that we have a mount at the top. From the mount, all the IOs that you do will be coming to the brick to get stored at one point. So when it comes through the brick, let's assume you did a write. So this write is going to come here, and then you are doing a read. The next read will be coming. So when it comes, it has to cross this changelog translator, which is on the way. And this changelog is going to record everything to the flat file. And at one point, agent is going to read this flat file and send it to the worker for it to copy from the master to the slave mount. So this is how basically georep syncs your data from the master to the slave mount. So the disadvantages with the current approach is that we have something called a GFID in Gluster, which is more similar to an inode in a file system. So using this GFID is what Gluster identifies each and every file in the whole volume. It's going to be a unique identifier for each file. And as of now, the whole structure of your file system is linked through GFIDs. So from the master to the slave, we are going to replicate this whole structure. So here, we try to have the same GFID on the master to be synced on to the slave, and we perform all the operations based on GFIDs. This was the easier approach which we have we are using currently, and it does have drawbacks like the slave is supposed to be a Gluster volume only, then it can understand what a GFID is. So you can't manually copy whatever you want from the master to the slave. That's a drawback because we won't have the GFIDs there. And other Gluster problems like GFID conflicts and stuff. Apart from that, let's assume that there is a scenario in which you create a file and then you delete the file and then you create the file again. With the current approach, we are going to reproduce all these three operations on the slave. But if you see, the create and delete are actually not necessary because you are again creating the file. You just have to create it once instead of doing it thrice. So these drawbacks are currently there in the current approach. So we are going to, and the other problem is, there can be races between creating and deleting a particular directory in the master volume. So the order in which these operations go further can result in various situations, and that's not a good thing for syncing the data from the master to the slave. And how we got around this issue is through something called as a path-based geo-replication. So what we did is, instead of having this GFID for each file being synced from the master to the slave, we created a workaround where a GFID's path is stored, sorry, a file's parent is stored in the file itself. This way, every time you have a file, you know the parent of the file and you can create a path of that file. Using this path, you just send it to the slave volume and ask it to create the file in the particular path. Now the structure whichever was linked through GFIDs is actually broken down into path which is linked, which is easier. So this is done using the concept like, so you create a file. When you create this file, in the file's exactor, we put up this parent information so that you can create the path. And we use a tool called GFID to find, which is capable of generating the whole path from the file. So the slave just gets the path now instead of getting the GFID and constructing the whole thing back up there. This way we have simplified the process and the dependency on GFID is removed. So the advantages of this approach is that, as you see, GFIDs aren't necessary, need not be same on the master and the slave. The slave doesn't even need a GFID, so it doesn't need to be a Gluster volume to mount it. So right now you can sync. With this approach, you can sync a Gluster volume to any other particular volume, be it your normal file system, Ceph, or whichever you want. You can sync it to that. That's an advantage. And in case if you see any failures during a sync for a particular file, you can manually copy that file from the master to the slave. That's yet another advantage which we don't have right now. And if you remember the hybrid crawl where I was saying we have to crawl through the file system and then create the change logs, that was quite expensive, doing a whole crawl on the file system. Instead, here we can come up with tools which is just going to go through the file system and then paste it on, sync it to the slave. This way we can reduce certain overheads over here, and these will be the advantages of a basic path-based geo-replication. And the demo, so I'll show how to set up a basic geo-replicated, yes?
Mind enlarging the character set a bit?
A little more. Is this
Thanks.
Fine?
Yeah.
So I'll explain how to create a volume, master volume, and sync it to the slave with this demo. So I'm actually now getting inside a machine where I'm. So the first step would be to create the trusted storage pool. And to create the trusted storage pool, you have to peer probe from one particular node. So let's assume that we are in 134. From 134, I'm peer probing to 136. And so now the cluster, the trusted storage pool has two servers, if you see. So these two will be the servers. And in this, I'm going to create the master volume now. So you see that there are two bricks. This will be one brick, and this will be the other brick, each on one of the servers. And using these, I've created a master Gluster volume called master volume. And then I am starting the master volume. After this, I am creating yet another volume called shared storage, which is something you can leave right now because it's necessary only if you create a replicated volume, or else that's not necessary. If you want, I can explain that later. And then I'm starting that particular volume as well. Oops. Okay. Sorry. So, what I've done is I have the master volume. Wait, I'll go back to the line. Yeah. So here with this command, I'm mounting the particular master volume on that particular directory of this machine. Now you have a mount where you can write files and it will be stored in the particular brick. And then I'm doing the same for the other volume as well. So once done with this, I'm creating a session between two volumes. And the step is, so you can use this command instead of creating the second volume I'm showing now. Here, as I have created the second volume, it's saying that it is not necessary. And then this is the first command where the first command that is necessary for the geo-replication. So what happens here is with this command, each of your server will have a SSH key generated, and all those SSH keys will be collected to the initiator node, which is 134. So from that, I'm using this command to push these SSH keys to the server, and the server is going to be 70. And between the server 70 and 134, I have already done a passwordless SSH, so it can move things there. So I'm pushing the SSH keys, and this will be helpful in actually syncing your files. The syncing of the files is basically done using rsync or tar over SSH, and that's the reason we are sharing these keys. And then this is to use the volume that I created. So I'm starting the Georep session here, saying a start. After this, you can see that the status is getting initialized. And then I'll log on to the master machine and show you. Before that, I'll show the master volume. So if you see, I'm doing an ls on the master's mount, and we don't have any files created as of now. I'm SSHing into the slave cluster, and in that particular slave cluster, you can see that I've done the same procedure. I've created a trusted storage pool by peer probing, and then I've created a volume called slave, and on this particular slave volume, I'm doing an ls to see what is the content inside the slave, and you can see that the content is quite empty now. And now I go back to the master cluster, where I create 10 files right now in the master's mount, and you can see the 10 files being created. And I again SSH back to the slave and do an ls on the slave mount, and you can see the 10 files being copied on from the master to the slave. So with these minimum number of steps, it's easy to set up a Gluster volume, two Gluster volumes, and have Georep between them and get your data synced from one data center to the other. And Gluster is quite simple. You can do it even with a single node, but just to get an understanding of peer probing and stuff, I have showed this. But yeah, the size of the volume and stuff differs based on the way you create the volume. So that's it with the demo. Any questions? Yes?
What about scalability of replicas? How many replicas can I, sanely configure?
Yeah, so your master volume and your slave volumes are totally independent. The size, it's just that when you create the session, you have to, the geo-replication start command will make sure that there's yet another command before that, push perms, that will make sure that your slave is bigger in size than the master. If that's the case, the geo-replication will start fine. So when you basically expand your volume, you're going to expand your master separately. And similarly, when you're running out of storage, you have to expand your slave separately. So those will be done as a separate command called Gluster volume add brick and so on. These ways you add more bricks, which means you're going to add more disks and you'll have a bigger storage.
This is like extending the storage size.
Yes.
I was more thinking about adding multiple
Yes, you can do that. You are talking about multiple slaves, right?
Yes,
you can create multiple slave volumes and establish.
Because n larger than two sites, that's what I'm talking about, right?
So
master to two or three or n slaves.
Yes, that's possible right now.
And
you
so
have to create.
What about scalability in that regard? What would you recommend as a maximum or what is supported?
So right now, I have seen volumes where we sync from one master to around three slaves and so on. So that's fine, but I don't know where the limit is. So that is something that I have left to look into. Yeah.
Does the transfer, I think you mentioned you use RSafe as a
yes.
Say I'm basically replicating large files.
Okay.
When it like gets interrupted at 90%,
mm-hmm.
what does it do?
So I talked about change logs, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if, with every change log, let's assume that you have you are creating a file of 100 GBs, and 99 GBs is copied, and the last 1 GB is yet to be copied.
Right.
So here what happens is, change log is not going to give it as a whole chunk of 100 GBs. It's going to give you as few MBs or KBs. So if it fails at a particular point, until that point, whatever was there will be fine. And whatever failed will again be something that will be tried again. That's something I have mentioned here. Retry a particular operation alone. So let's assume that after the 99th GB, there is a write going on and that failed. So we retry that write so that it passes and then it again continues. So this is how we have handled it. Yes. It's going to be on the master. Sorry, I didn't get that part.
How do you trace on the master side what was already written to the slave?
How do you trace it on the master side?
Yeah, how changelog will tell you if you do not have, for example, 10%, if 10% left.
Oh, it's not that way. So let's assume that you have a file
mm-hmm.
and you're starting to write 10 MBs after each, like first 10 MB, second 10 MB, and so on. So every time you write your first 10 MB or so on, 1 minute, I'll show you this. Huh. So from the mount, it's going to come back to the brick where it's going to be saved, right? So the first 10 MBs you write will come to the brick crossing the change log. So change log is going to make a record of the first 10 MBs in the flat file. And then comes the next 10 MB and next 10 MB and so on. So this way, when you get this flat file will have a list of all the writes that came in one after the other with the timing. And the agent is the one which would be aware that I have synced the first 10 MB, I have to sync the next 10 MB. This is done using the times. So the timestamp of the first one, let's assume is first 10 MB was written in 10 minutes, sorry, some n time, and your next 10 MB comes in n plus 1. So agent will read the n plus 1 because it knows that the checkpoint is at n. So the n plus 1th copy will be taken from the flat file, queried from the master, and then written on to the slave. Does that explain? Yeah. So on the slave side, you just send the writes, and based on the output from the rsync or stuff, you get to know if this particular write was a success or a failure. So this is the only way you know if it is actually written down to the slave. And if it is written down, then you do mark it as that particular rsync till that checkpoint. Any other questions? So, path-based geo-replication is being worked by Arvinda, and he's working on another project called Cuddaloo, which is integrating Gluster for containers. And the Gluster team from Red Hat is Kotrish, Sunny, and Shweta, apart from me. And if you have any questions, you can reach out in all these means. And we do have Gluster community meetings where you can attend the meeting and ask your questions in person to clarify if you have any issues as well. And all the links are mentioned in the presentation, and you can use that. Thank you.